Can you hear me? It's always you know, difficult to follow the dabbawalas, and but I'll still try my best. And the fact that, you know, an India-Pakistan match is about to start in half an hour, so you know, since it's an 18-minute presentation, I'm sure you know, you can all leave before the match starts. Okay. So you know, when I was doing my MBA, we had a director who was more of a dictator. And one of his, okay, I see people relate to that. So, we had a director who was more of a dictator, and one of his, one thing that he loved particularly was setting up lectures early morning on a Sunday. And the way it worked was, if you did not turn up, the cost of the lecture would be divided among the number of students who did not turn up. So if, let's say, you know, the guest faculty who was brought in, and it cost him, you know, it cost the institute 30,000 rupees to get him there. And if two people did not turn up, you know, the fine was 15,000 rupees. And believe me, you know, it did happen. So, I mean, it did happen to me. My fine was around 800 rupees once. But we all learned a lesson. We used to turn up on time Sunday morning. So, thank you for turning up. And, you know, what I wanted to talk about today is what I call the Ramesh Sippy syndrome. Or why we don't know which idea will work. I mean, I'm sure all of you know who Ramesh Sippy is. He is the director of this movie called Sholay. He's directed a lot of other movies as well, but this is his most famous movie. And so the idea for this topic came through a conversation I had with a friend of mine. You know, I have been living in Mumbai for almost 9 years now, and Mumbai is a city which eats, breathes, drinks, and even sleeps cinema. And being in the city, you cannot avoid cinema anywhere. And so obviously, you know, you end up having friends in the film industry. And we were talking about the fact that, you know, how Sholay is such a brilliant movie. I mean, nothing new, we all talk about it. But this was during the week the 3D version of Sholay had released. And both of us had seen it, and what we realized was that even though the movie runs into 207 minutes, you don't realize that it runs into 207 minutes. It's so well made. And this almost 40 years after it was first released. And so during the course of our conversation, this friend told me a very interesting story about Ramesh Sippy, and that led to this topic. And what he told me was that, you know, Ramesh Sippy gave up his financial stake in the movie Sholay before the movie was released. So that was because originally the movie was supposed to be shot over a period of 9 months, and because of you know, Jaya Bhaduri's pregnancy and a lot of other issues, the movie was shot for almost 2 years. It took 2 years to complete the movie, and because of that, the cost of production went terribly overboard. So if Sippy had a financial stake in the movie, what that would have meant was, if the movie ended up making losses, he would have to share those losses as well. So he gave up his financial stake in Sholay, thinking that, you know, it's a smart thing to do. So now, a couple of weeks after, you know, me and my friend had this conversation, Mayank Shekhar, who is a film critic, wrote about this incident in the Open magazine, where he said, you know, he says precisely the same thing. Ramesh apparently decided to surrender his financial stake in Sholay. He probably didn't want to share the losses that seemed imminent. And, you know, for the movie, when it released, when it released on August 15th, 1975, now these were the days when, you know, there were no 3,200 prints being released simultaneously all over India. The movie released just in the Bombay city, and what was Bombay, now it's Mumbai. And it was universally panned by all film critics and trade critics. In fact, I was talking to a trade critic recently, and he told me that, you know, he was just starting his career back then, and he told me when he had seen the movie in its first week of release, he found it to be terrible. And that was what the general feedback was. The trade guide called it Chole, famously, so referring to its likely return on investment. The trade guide was not the only one. K.L. Almati, who was the film critic for India Today, famously called it Dead Ember. Ember, as you would know, is the English word for Chole. So he called it Dead on Arrival, basically. This is from Anupama Chopra's book on the making of Chole. Bikram Singh, who was the film critic for Filmfare, which was the biggest film magazine then, said that you know, the entire idea of trying to set a Western into an Indian environment doesn't really work. So, you know, within for the first week, it seemed that, you know, Ramesh Sippy might probably have made you know, a very good decision. But suddenly things started to change. And one of the first guys who observed this change was the manager of this cinema, Geeta Cinema in Worli, in Mumbai. I stay in Worli. I don't think this cinema is around. It's probably you know, been done away with for a high-rise complex or something like that. And so this gentleman, the manager, was speaking to Ramesh Sippy and was trying to tell Sippy ki, boss, tumhara picture chal raha hai. So Sippy obviously asked him, you know, how can you say that? The feedback's awful, the critics have panned it. So he said, you know, my sales of cold drinks and snacks have gone down during the interval. So Sippy was wondering, you know, what has that got to do with, you know, Chole being this, you know, becoming a hit. And he was told, you know, when sales go down during an interval, what it tells me is that people want the movie to start again quickly. They are looking forward to it, and they don't want to go out, you know, and come back and miss a scene or two by the time they come back. And then there's this great story about Shashi Kapoor watching the movie over a weekend with his drivers and kids and loving the movie, and then calling up Amitabh Bachchan and telling him, you know, the boss, the movie is working. Until then, you know, everyone had given up on the movie, and they were even thinking of reshooting the end. You know, a lot of people said that Amitabh Bachchan dying did not work, and so on and so forth. The only guys who had confidence in Chole were the writers, Salim and Javed, and they even brought out an ad in one of the trade magazines saying that Chole will do business of 1 crore in each territory, which it did, and you know, it did a lot more than that. And obviously, you know, a lot of money was made on Chole, and people still continue to make money on Chole. And G.P. Sippy, who was Ramesh's father and the producer of Chole, the story goes that every time he wanted to produce a new movie and was low on cash, he would re-release Chole, get the money, and then go and produce another movie. And that, I mean, and you know, the fact that he made Chole led to him producing a lot of crappy stuff in the late 80s and early 90s, because, you know, he had the money coming in through Chole. So, you know, one of the movies was that he produced was Patthar Ke Phool, famously starred Salman Khan and Raveena Tandon. And another interesting movie that he produced was this movie called Bhrashtachar, which starred Mithun Chakravarti and Rekha, and had one of the most famous rape scenes in Hindi cinema. So everyone made money from Chole, the distributors. There's a great story in Anupama Chopra's book on the making of Chole about a blacker making so much money that he could marry his daughter off and buy a couple of flats in Mumbai. You know, that's a huge thing even today. But Ramesh Sippy never made any money from it, because he had given up his stake. And he was obviously paid for directing the movie, but beyond that, he did not. Now, you know, what am I trying to say over here? You know, Ramesh Sippy was probably the closest to the movie. He was the director, he had a clue of what is happening, but he did not see the success of the movie coming, you know, and he gave up his stake in the movie. And a lot of other people also did not see the success of the movie coming. And but once the movie was a hit, everybody started to analyze it. You know, why does this work? You know, as Seth Godin said, it is remarkable. You know, but it's very easy to point out things that are remarkable after they have happened. Nobody said Chole was remarkable when it first released or while it was being made. And so I also tried to, you know, study the success of Chole. And I once made this presentation on Chole, and I said Chole was successful because it followed the principles of management. And believe me, the professor was very impressed and he gave me the highest marks in the class. But I knew I was bullshitting, pardon my French. So, you know, everybody had a reason for Sholay working, and people have tried to rework Sholay over the years. Subhash Ghai made Karma, Rajkumar Santoshi made China Gate, but nothing has come close to the success of Sholay, even though people have tried to remake it over and over again. Ram Gopal Verma made Ram Gopal Verma Ki Aag. I think after that, probably no one will try and remake the movie. Okay, so, you know, from Sholay, the next example I wanted to talk about is Kolhapuri D. Huge hit, you know, two and a half years back. And if you look at the song, there is nothing going for it. It's been sung by a guy who cannot sing, who is relatively unknown in large parts of India. He's a superstar in Tamil Nadu. It's got barely any lyrics, some in Tamil, some English. The music director was a newcomer, you know, a cousin of Dhanush's wife. There was no publicity on the song, it was just uploaded one fine day on YouTube, but it just took off. And what it did also was it inspired versions in various languages. One of the famous versions was sung by Sonu Nigam's son. I don't know if you've seen it. There was even a version in my father's mother tongue, Kashmiri, which was quite funny. So Kolhapuri D was a huge hit, and everybody then, you know, when once this happens, people start saying things, this was inevitable, it was bound to be a hit. So everybody started analyzing it. And this was what happened. Okay. This is... this happened. I didn't make it up. This is from a Times of India report. I am in Ranchi. I was born and brought up in Ranchi, so I try and keep track of what is happening in the city. And it was great fun knowing that the city has an IIM now, but you know, this is this kind of... So they organized a conference to understand the success of the song. Then there were other analysts. Someone told me that it's because it follows the KISS strategy. Keep it simple, stupid. I said, okay. Someone else analyzed it. It was out of the box thinking. Okay. Someone else said the song worked because it was melodious. Yes. The point is, you know, a lot of other songs would be true on all these parameters that I'm talking about, but they are nowhere as big as, you know, as Kolhapuri D went on to become. So it's always easy to analyze success after it has happened, but that does not mean that those were the reasons, you know, which led to the success of that idea, the song. Okay. This is, you know, just a question. I was told it always helps to, you know, interact with the audience. So, in the late 1990s, the founders of a particular company tried to sell the company for $1.6 million. They could not because the buyer was not willing to pay more than $1 million. Okay? Any guess? Which company am I talking about? Just take a wild guess, yeah. Google. So Google, the founders, Brin and Page, tried to sell the company for $1.6 million, but the buyer was not ready to pay more than $1 million. So who was, you know, he obviously, you know, it turned out to be a very stupid decision in retrospect because Google is worth more than $400 billion now. And there are, you know, there is almost a book every week trying to analyze the success of Google. But the irony is that the guys who, you know, started Google did not know that the company will become so successful. So, you know, there are lots of such ideas. You know, I can keep talking to you an entire day on, but I'll just share a few of them. Columbia Records refused to release Bob Dylan's Like a Rolling Stone. They eventually did, and it went on to become a huge hit. J.K. Rowling's Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone was rejected by 12 publishers till Bloomsbury published it. J.K. Rowling has been the biggest publishing phenomenon in the last 20-25 years. And it happened in India also. Chetan Bhagat's 5-point someone did the rounds. Amish's trilogy on Shiva went to 22 publishers. And, you know, I have met him a few times. I was at DNA. He was the chief marketing officer of IDBI Life Insurance. We were on the same floor and he used to keep standing on the floor and keep smoking all the time. So, I mean, that does not mean marketing guys don't have any work, but okay, and the fact that he was probably writing the book while he was working there. But that's beside the point. The point is, he had to finally self-publish the book. And after he had self-published it and it went on to become a huge hit, then he got a publisher. So, now this is about Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone. The first print run was 1,000 copies. You know, my first book was recently published. My print run was better than that. I mean, I can't tell you what my print run was, but it was definitely better than that. So, Infosys, great example. Probably the most talked about Indian company in the last 30 years, last 20 years at least. The company came out with an IPO in 1993. They could not sell all the shares that they wanted to. And ultimately, those shares had to be picked up by their investment banker. Nobody saw the success of Infosys coming. When Infosys, so nobody saw the success of Infosys coming. Neither did they see the success of Bharti Airtel. The IPO came in at a price of 45 rupees, and all the analysts going around panned the stock. When the stock listed, it fell to as low as 23 rupees. And even at that price, people were not willing to buy. Bharti Airtel has been one of the biggest wealth creators in the last 15 years. And the same set of analysts recommended this stock called Reliance Power, which did not go anywhere. So these analysts saw, you know, Reliance Power as being a very successful company when they did not see Bharti Airtel. So, you know, what happens is after success comes, success of an idea, book, movie, everybody, you know, latches on and they say that, you know, this was a phenomenon waiting to happen. And, you know, we all have our reasons around it. And what happens is once, you know, something has succeeded, you go around looking for stories and you build a story and then you explain that this is why something worked. So you always tell a story after an event which purports to be account for much further greater popularity of one compared to another. This is a British economist, Paul Ormerod. Michael Mosa, in a fiercely competitive market, the thinking goes, only the best products rise to the surface. Once a product is a hit, whether a blockbuster movie or a best-selling book, we readily point to the attributes that make it so appealing. You know, if quality was a consideration for things becoming popular, you know, Salman Khan movies would never have been popular. But people go out and watch it. So there is a great need for post-facto rationalization. Once a thing has become successful, you know, we go looking for reasons. And that is because everybody loves a story. You know, as human beings, we want explanations. And the better an explanation is, you know, it's we prefer explanations that are definitive and offer clear implications. On a side note, you know, being management students, if there is one book that you guys should read in 2 years or 5 years that you spend here, it has to be The Halo Effect. All that you are taught in your classes will go for a toss. Then there is the network effect at work. And the network effect is essentially very, very simple. And it is a reason for the success of a lot of things which are then overanalyzed later. The network effect is essentially, you know, demand for a product creates more demand for a product. You know, you look at something like a Facebook. I am on Facebook because everybody else is on Facebook. I was told 2 years back that Google Plus is a much better product. But nobody has moved to Google Plus. People are still on Facebook. And that's the reason why Facebook has paid $19 billion for WhatsApp, a company which does not earn any money, because the network effect is at work. These are the last two slides. And this is a beautiful quote. You know, there was a few years back, there was this book called Eat, Shoots, and Leaves, which was a bestseller. And when its publisher was asked, it's, you know, the reason behind its success, he replied, it sold because a lot of people bought it.